education. But that's not to say I knew very much about it, just knew the sort of broad strokes. And so when Diego approached me about playing Helen, I had no idea who she was. I'd never heard of Helen. I'd heard of Dolores Huerta and I'd heard of Cesar, but not Helen. And I was quite nervous that the role would be of the kind of supportive, inactive, standing by wife instead of being in the thick of the movement. And what I learned was that Helen was played such a critical role in the formation of the union, in the day-to-day activity of the union. She ran the credit union. She pamphleted. She protested. She got arrested. She sent her kids out to be involved in it as well. She cooked for, as her husband's lying, starving himself and fasting, which she completely opposed. She stood outside and cooked for the people who were there holding vigil. She was so active and on top of fulfilling all her roles as a mother and a house, maintaining her household. And so.
How much research did you do into Helen? What kind of materials were available to you? Because the boys were saying they had plenty of video and YouTube and history.
Yeah.
But I know even in my looking around and probing and things, I didn't find that much about specifically on Helen.
There isn't that much out there about Helen, partly by her own choosing. I mean, she was not a public she is not a public persona, and she never wanted to be, and really refused that aspect of the whole situation. So you're right, there's not that many photos of her, there's barely any recording. We all had to work on the accents for each character. The accents were incredibly specific to region, to background, to the era, the time, and I was sort of left with very little to go on because I couldn't find a recording of Helen's voice. And I sort of did as much research of the time I could and then used my imagination. But the day before filming, our researcher sent me like an 8-second clip that she had found of Helen at 35 or something talking, and I almost broke down crying saying, thank you for this amazing gem. And I listened to those 8 seconds over and over and over again to try and to match her voice. But there was very little out there about her. I had the privilege of meeting her, of spending some time with her, and really just experiencing her presence and her essence. And she's incredibly strong and in a very still way, in a very quiet way, and yet she's warm and emotional and wears her feelings on her sleeve, but is a woman whose boundaries you know to respect. So that was invaluable for me to get to spend time with her and hear her talk about some of her memories and some of her stories, and to hear her kids talk about her. So I had less on the internet to go by and more of just the personal interactions with her and her family to try and construct a character of her.
Was there one instance that she might have spoken to you about from the movement, from at the height of the movement, that was that most defining or stood out most to her and then in turn to you?
Well, I think one of the things that really stuck with me was that, she, when they were living quite a comfortable life in Los Angeles before Cesar decided to go back and form the union, and she was raising 8 children in Los Angeles, she didn't have to work because Cesar made plenty of money. And then when he made this decision to go back, which she supported, she went back to the fields to earn money.
Yeah.
He went back to the fields to organize, and she went back to the fields to put food on the table. And to me, that spoke, just volumes about, this woman and how she felt about the cause. I mean, she supported Cesar because he was her husband, but she had an intense connection to this cause. She worked in the fields from the time she was 7 years old. So she was in this cause for her own dignity, for the rights and the dignity of her and her own family. So, this wasn't sort of like a woman standing by her man, but this was a woman sort of standing up and fighting for her own experience.
I was really impressed by your role. I mean, I was really impressed by you, actually, in the role. But and Michael isn't here today, and I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how it was working with him.
Yeah, well, Michael and I had actually worked together just less than a year before this, doing a film called End of Watch, where we were cops and had a very different dynamic going. There was a lot of testosterone coming out of me and everyone on that set, and we were sort of, you know, bros on the force together, and we had to sort of switch on a dime and say, okay, now you're my husband. And so it was nice to already kind of have established a familiarity with Michael, and we spent time, you know, we went on a road trip up to La Paz and a road trip to Delano, and spent time just the two of us, you know, in the, you know, visiting the sites and the streets and the fields that this story actually happened on. And and so, you know, we spent a lot of time talking about what that relationship was. You know, I think it's really the easy route to say, okay, so this was a loving, supporting relationship, but it was very clear to us that there was a lot of complexity in the relationship, in the conflicting obligations that, you know, Helen supported the movement and supported her husband and was devoted to him till today. But she also would do anything to protect her family and her children. And so she sometimes had conflicting interests, you know, as a mother and as a woman with big ideals. So we talked a lot about what that relationship must have been, and you know, I loved hearing from her kids that you know, Cesar couldn't, like, he shared everything with her, and that he wouldn't make decisions without talking to her, and didn't know how he felt about a lot of things until Helen had weighed in, and there was a lot of love and respect in the relationship, and that was really exciting to get to portray the conflict, but also the devotion to one another. Mm-hmm.
Do you think you'd ever direct your own movie?
I've directed a short film, which was a learning experience. And I loved it. I loved doing it. I made a lot of mistakes, and I was not very good at it, but I had a great time doing it, and I would be completely open to directing a story that I felt, you know, uniquely compelled to tell from my perspective. I've been doing a lot more developing and producing lately, in both film and television, being a part of that creative process from behind the camera, and I love it and find it very fulfilling. Every time I work on anything, I'm always marvel at the role of the director. I mean, you know, you're the first one up and the last one gone, and you have to hold the vision for everyone and be incredibly present and specific in the small moments and still hold the space for the entire project to work over years of coming together. So I have an enormous amount of awe and respect for what directors do, and while it seems like a really exciting thing to do, I'm not under any delusions that I'm prepared and ready to do that. So maybe one day, but I don't have any plans right now.
Speaking of directors, we've got Diego here. It's essentially the second feature. He's done a couple of shorts.
Yeah.
But in addition to maintaining and finding that balance of the tone and the performance, here is that added extra factor of the historical accuracy, and this is a real historical person, mm-hmm. that impacted the world.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think, you know, with your knowledge in front of the camera, in the creative process, and working with so many directors, how would you describe Diego's handle and development of this film,
yeah.
and finding that tonal balance?
I think Diego's commitment was always to the story, and that he knew that we could do as much research as possible, and we could, you know, we could try and be as accurate as, you know, we could try and know as much as we could, but when it came down to it, we had to let those things go and make sure that we were telling the story that he set out to make. And when he spoke to me, he said, this is a story about a father about a husband, about a man who made a lot of sacrifices, not about Chavez the hero, but Chavez who was the man. And he was incredibly devoted to creating those moments where, you know, you could see the real sacrifices that he and those around him, most of all his children and his wife, made for him to be able to accomplish, you know, what he did. And so, you know, I don't think Diego set out to make a documentary. I think he set out to tell it, to really tell the story that he connected to as a father, you know, who makes sacrifices in his own life to either, you know, to benefit his career at his family's expense or to benefit his family at his career's expense, and that juggling that we all do. And so I think he was always really deeply connected to the human level, and I think that it's an incredibly brave thing to do, to be the first to dive into an issue that surprisingly hasn't been touched by cinema. This is the first, it's really hard to believe that this is the first narrative feature told about Cesar Chavez, and the truth is not, no one story could ever, no one film could ever hope to encapsulate the magnitude of the movement and the amount of perspectives and the amount of experiences. You know, there's still so many perspectives on this one event that need to be told, and I think the greatest hope for all of us is that this is just the beginning of the conversation, and that it would inspire other filmmakers and other, you know, other people out there to say, you know, there's more to be said on this. It's not the final word, and I think that Diego would be the first to say that this was his perspective as a storyteller, what he connected to. Okay.